This is the Final Whistle podcast from the Wrexham AFC media team. The final score from the racecourse, Wrexham 1, Sutton United 0. That was a big result, even if the teams above us won, which makes the top three look, you know, not so likely. Still, to keep the pressure on like that with a win is impressive. And I've got to say that we've won an awful lot of 1-0 games at the racecourse this season, and this was a bit more fluent than quite a few of them. We've been sort of really working hard for a lot of them. This one, we were on top of it for most of the game, and with this new formation, which is intended to inject some creativity, we did look threatening. We had to wait till the 78th minute for the goal, but nonetheless, we got it from a set piece. And as a result of that, we've held on to victory and equaled the club record for most clean sheets in the season. 26 kept this season. An impressive achievement. Wrexham started as an unchanged side, unsurprisingly, and started off positively, as you'll hear when we talk about what happened later on in the podcast with myself and Colin Henrys. Mark Harrington, from the start at left-back, was constantly punching balls down the flank, turning the defence, and clearly this was Wrexham's game plan, asking questions of Sutton's defenders. A tremendous ball over the top in the seventh minute by him led to the first significant incident. Holroyd with a great run in off the back of his man. The keeper, Warner, who went viral last week with his spectacular mistake to gift Leighton Orient a penalty in the last minute, came quickly off his line and did well to just get there first and save at Holroyd's feet. He took a kick for his troubles. Holroyd flew over him and appeared to land on his head. It was rather worrying. They both needed treatment. It was worrying for Wrexham because, obviously, Holroyd could have been badly hurt. It was worrying for Sutton because they had no sub-keeper on the bench. But both of them were able to continue. Wrexham continued to push on with the front three full of endeavour and movement. Bevan chasing a ball down, feeding Grant. He got to Rutherford, who cut inside and squared the ball to Grant. And from the edge of the area, he pulled his shot about a foot wide off the right post. Then, Grant picking the ball up on the edge of the area after some nice interchange between Holroyd and Roberts. The ball, in the end, dropping to Grant on the edge of the area. He drove in the shot, but it hit a defender, and that took the pace off her a bit, so Warner was able to make a fairly straightforward save low down to his right. Grant then involved teeing a chance up, squaring the ball on 20 yards out to Holroyd, and he hit his shot just wide of the left post. Sutton showing very little in this time, playing a sort of diamondy, but often one of the other central mids would come and join the defensive one, and they had two defensive mids standing on the toes of the centre backs. The wide men weren't getting forwards much, and they were leaving the two strikers very, very isolated. One of those two strikers was the ex Wrexham trialist, remember trialist B, Jimmy Toure, and he had the first effort of any note really for Sutton just before the half hour mark, 25 yards out. Nice footwork by him, trying to find a bit of space and scooping in a shot that Leighton was comfortable to leave as it soared over the bar. Then Wrexham were coming forwards again. Carrington surging forwards, beating two men down the left hand side, and then swinging in a great cross to the far post. Grant getting up 6 yards out, but just couldn't place it. As Colin said in commentary, maybe the cross, if it had a bit more pace on it, Grant could have just steered it in, tried to place it in, put it a foot wide of the far post. Then Carrington sticking a diagonal into the box, Bevan climbing, nodding it down nicely. Holroyd bringing it down, couldn't quite get a shot off. Grant also had squirted loose. Akeel Wright attacked it. It span out to the edge of the area. Carrington picking it up left of centre, got onto his right foot, tried to shift it out there and hit a right-footed curler into the top right corner and didn't quite bring it down enough. Still, Wrexham kept pushing. Sutton were keeping a very high line from set pieces and were nearly caught out by that. It's a horrific piece of defending, really. Free kick on the halfway line to Wrexham. Launched in behind that high line, they somehow managed to let Akeel Wright get in behind them onside. He nodded it down into the goal mouth. Keeper started to come for it, but it hit a defender standing in front of him and dropped invitingly into an empty 6 yard box. Pearson wanted to have to tap in, but unluckily for him, there was a defender in the way who managed to get to it first. At the other end, the half ended with a rare attack by Sutton.
Buseyman standing at diagonal into the box, Toure nodding it down, Williams driving in a shot, which is well blocked by Pearson. Not the last time one of his shots would be blocked by Pearson. It happened again in the last minute of the second half too, and would be rather more decisive. But anyway, Wrexham came out in the second half again, looking to maintain that good tempo. Bevan charging the goalkeeper down, the ball spinning out to the right-hand side, players pouring into the box, and Sutton's defence not set, but Roberts wasn't able to get an angle to swing an early cross in, and the danger went away. Then, 10 minutes into the half, nearly a real fluke. Nice for Leighton to get the clean sheet record. He nearly also scored. He had the ball at his feet on the edge of his area, hit it long. It took a nasty bounce in front of Warner. Well, I don't know, maybe I'm being a bit generous there. It bounced in front of Warner and span over him. I think maybe got a bit underneath it. And he had to leap high to his left to claw it behind for a corner. So close, Leighton, to becoming the first Wrexham goalkeeper, I'm pretty sure, to score in open play. We had Dave Gaskell score a penalty for Wrexham in the 60s, but yeah, I'm pretty sure no keeper's ever actually done that for Wrexham, just hit it one length of the pitch to the other. Wrexham continued to push on. Bevan, who was a nuisance winning headers and just scrapping and creating 50-50 balls where you felt there shouldn't be one, nodded the ball down. There was a scramble in the box. Luke Summerfield had just come on. He managed to charge the ball down and span across again to the box, but nobody got the decisive touch. It came back in, and Carrington won a free kick. The Wrexham fans were shouting that it was in the area. Carrington didn't really ask for that, though. It was right on the goal line, left-hand side, dinked in, under the bar. The keeper came, fumbled it. There was a scramble, and in the end, nothing came of it. Or did it? It could be this was a sort of quite a key moment here, because what happened next maybe wasn't that significant, but enormously lifted the atmosphere. The Wrexham fans constantly throughout the game were getting frustrated that Sutton players going down looking for treatment. By my reckoning, if my memory is correct, five times Sutton players went down holding their heads and asking and got treatment. And obviously when it's a head injury, the referee's got to be cautious and have sympathy for the ref in those situations. But the Wrexham fans had enough. Their anger had been building. The Wrexham players, too, were furious when, after that free kick dinked into the box, Warner, the goalkeeper, stayed down, holding his head. Play had to be stopped. He was treated, but was up fairly quickly. And Wrexham were livid. Pearson was dogging the referee. And when the free kick was finally... the drop ball was finally going to be taken, Wrexham decided they were going to contest it. So Wrexham crowded the Sutton penalty area to contest the drop ball. And the referee then did something which, well, you know, any referees out there want to correct me, please do so. He made the rules up himself. He clearly wanted to just give the ball back to Sutton. Wrexham refused. Pearson was very animated, arguing with him. And the referee seemed to not so much drop the ball, just throw it to the keeper. You can't do that. If a team wants to contest a drop ball, surely they have to contest a drop ball. Wrexham were furious. The crowd went mad. The tempo lifted. That's not the introduction of Summerfield. Rutherford, who'd taken a knock, also helped because Summerfield was really looking to get the ball forwards early. And Wrexham started to really get the tempo going. The crowd were lifted. Sutton were forced back. We were pummeling balls forwards, testing the back four. They made a change in their back four, bringing Aswad Thomas in as a left back because there was the real danger down the flanks as well as through the middle. And they had to rearrange things and put more defensive player on. And finally, in the 78th minute, came the breakthrough. Luke Young with a corner from the right-hand side, swung it beyond the far post. Pearson got up and headed it past the keeper. It was cleared off the line. A scramble continued. The ball bobbled around till it span up towards the penalty spot. And Kieran Kennedy did absolutely brilliantly to control a right-footed volley. The ball still high up when he made contact and launch it into the top right corner. Terrific finish by the centre-back, and Wrexham had the lead. Sutton reacted by changing to a 4-2-4 and trying to throw everything at Wrexham. And they did look a little bit more dangerous. There was a nice chip in towards the 6-yard box. Brett Williams got up and missed his header completely. Moment of danger. At the other end, Wrexham were pushing on, though. Oswell and McGlashan had come on to try and change things around up front. Oswell, by the way, really putting himself about, gamely, fighting for absolutely everything and doing a manful job as a target man. McGlashan was rather wasteful down the right hand side, but there was one very freaky moment. Ball down the right hand side, McGlashan chasing it into the box, starting to sound familiar yet. This time the keeper comes out and, unlike at Barnet, beats McGlashan to the ball. Unfortunately, Aswad Thomas beats him to the ball as well, and the keeper and Thomas collide. The ball goes squirting out. McGlashan goes down a heap, asking for a penalty. It wasn't a penalty. The ball goes behind for a corner. Just for a second, it looked like he was going to replicate almost identically the goal at Barnet. Not only that, scarily enough, it happened in the same minute as well. Ooh, spooky. 5 minutes left. Wrexham pushing on again. Summerfield whipping a fantastic cross in to the edge of the 6 yard box. Oswell lunging at it with his right foot, just couldn't quite reach it. And Wrexham had sudden his arm's length apart from that moment I mentioned earlier. Williams had a shot blocked by Pearson in the last minute of the first half. He would have another in the second half, and it was more dangerous as well. It was a good near post cross. Williams turning 6 yards out and driving at a power, but Pearson got across well to block it. Wrexham then sustained a 20-second rearguard action in their penalty areas. Cross after cross came in, but finally Carrington did well to clear it, and Oswell did brilliantly to get his body between man and ball and win a free kick on the halfway line. And soon afterwards, Wrexham would ridden through the four added minutes and acclaimed victory. A massive, massive victory. A victory full of spirit, but also a victory which shows that this new formation just gives us a little bit more going forward, a little bit more threat. And if Summerfield can be fully fit and integrated into that, then we should have a little bit of momentum going for the playoffs. To hear further analysis of the match, have a listen to what Colin Henrys and I had to say after the final whistle on Callan FM.
This is the Final Whistle Podcast from the Wrexham AFC media team.
The Dasham will get there. It's got Oswell in the middle, but he surely keeps it in the corner flag. He doesn't have to, because there's the final whistle, and it's a huge final whistle for Wrexham. The hopes of finishing in the top three are alive. Wrexham managed to beat a dogged Sutton United side. They fully deserved it, though. And as a result of that, well, not only that, they grind out another 1-0 home win, which is our speciality, and we equal the club record for most clean sheets in the season. But that game, in many ways, epitomised our best route forwards in the playoffs, didn't it, really? We've got a bit more creativity, but we look solid as well when we haven't got the ball. It was encouraging.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's only 1-0. It was a very dominant 1-0. Of course, in those situations, you're hanging on at the end. But Wrexham fully deserved the win today. The goal came perhaps from an unlikely source at Kieran Kennedy, but the amount of times they've got forward, the play they've created, the clever touches, the nice little passes, it's been one of the best 1-0s of the season, I think, in a season full of 1-0s, if you said.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. We looked very threatening early on. It was a shame we couldn't get the finishing touch, but the fact of the matter was we did take the game to Sutton consistently in the first half and for most of the second. Seemed to get a little bit of a boost by Summerfield coming on, and also by the crowds getting involved when there was the anger about the time wasting as well. But basically, Wrexham, yeah, looked more creative than they have done in a lot of recent games. Again, 3 games in a row we played this formation, and again, it's looked more threatening. Again, there's a bit more promise about it. And then again, defensively, back in our clean sheet mode.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the clean sheet's probably almost just as important today, because as we said, Brian, you said it after the last few games, you wanted to get back to that clean sheet mentality. You mentioned Luke Summerfield, what an impact he made from the bench, and that's really encouraging to see that not only is the system working, but we've got players like Summerfield and Oswell to bring into that only complemented the system.
Sadly, Salford have scored
again,
so that's a pity for Wrexham. Looks like the teams above are all winning, going to win, but still keeps the hope alive, at least for another game, that Wrexham can come into the top three. Man of the match call. A lot of good performances out there, I thought.
Yeah, absolutely. I saw the sponsors gave it to Kieran Kennedy, as they would after the goal, and it was a vital goal and a good performance at the back from him and Sean Pearson. For me, I'm going to say Mark Carrington. I thought what he offered to the game going forward, and at the back, of course, of his experience, but it was his confidence, the pass he was playing. He looked like a man banging form, and I think that comes from the fact that there is this new confidence flowing through the team. Playing some beautiful, beautiful through balls. He was getting forward, bombing down the left and putting crosses in. And that's exactly what you want. You know, James Jennings, superb left back. Mark Carrington's got to take it to another level if he's going to stay there in that position, as good as he is himself. And today, for me, I think he did that.
I said, didn't I? And in the first half, I couldn't see what Sutton's game plan was. And I thought Carrington epitomised quite early on what Wrexham's game plan was. We were looking to turn the defence and get early service in down the flank. And Carrington, in the first half, was setting the tone there, wasn't he? Just constantly drilling those balls in for Bevan to chase, for Holroyd to chase, and just asking those questions of Sutton's defence. And he had a couple of good surges down the flank as well, which is slightly uncharacteristic of him, isn't it?
Yeah, as I say, originally he was offering a very different type of play to Roberts, who's another one. For all times I criticised him, I thought he was absolutely outstanding as well today.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But Carrington on the left, originally he was playing these three balls, like you said, the one very early on where Holroyd had that pass with the keeper and just about got there just too late. Then after that, it seemed to switch maybe midway through the half. All of a sudden, Carrington's the one bombing forward. He's put a lovely cross in for Bobby Grant on his left foot. And he's just offered so much more going forward too, as well as being that experienced head at the back, which when the pressure did eventually build a few times we saw towards the end, he did really well to hold the player from the left-hand side there. And yeah, it's, I mean, he's an experienced player, he's been here for a long time, we know what he offers, but it's always good to get a reminder of just how good Matt Carrington can be on this day.
Yeah, such a good pro, and such a reliable performer, a good performance in midfield as well. Like Keir Wright battled well for the ball. I like Luke Young in a slightly more withdrawn role because he keeps the ball moving well, and he can compete for it too. And I thought that Summerfield had an impact when he came on. I'm trying to claim he was man of the match. And that front three as well, newly configured and looking promising. Looks like there's good movement between them. And although maybe none of them have got lots of goals in them, there is threat when they combine together. Excellent stuff for Wrexham. The promotion push continues with the final score of Wrexham 1, Sutton United 0. I'll hand back to the studio.
This is the Final Whistle Podcast with the Wrexham AFC media team.